Fine. I'll just check if anyone's coming.
Do you know of other people that you always bring stuff?
Okay, let me just start. Okay. Fine. So, in today's lecture, what we're going to try to do is to understand understand black hole spacetime a little better than we did last time. So last time we did some intuitive calculations. I want to make these calculations more precise and more to get a more precise and better understanding of black hole spacetime. So the very important thing about black hole is its causal structure. Okay. And excellent. For this reason, what we're going to try to do is to understand how to characterize causal structures of spacetime. So let's first start with a really simple example. Let's start with flat space. Suppose that the d s squared is equal to dr squared plus minus d t squared plus dr squared plus r squared d omega. Okay. Now, the first thing I do is to do sort of what we tried to do with the black hole, that is, I define u is equal to r t minus r, so v is equal to t plus r. So these are the flat space outgoing and incoming coordinates, in the sense that u is constant along an outgoing geodesic, and v is constant along an ingoing gradient. Okay, now let's rewrite the metric in terms of u and v. So you see that, using opposite the metric to class. Okay, so you see that dt squared minus dr squared is simply du dt. Okay, so ds squared is equal to du dv minus r squared d omega 2 squared. So let's pause for a moment to note that u and v are, it's manifest from this form that u and v are null coordinates. Why is that? That's because if you keep v and the square points fixed, then the change of the interval is zero. Because there's no du squared. V is zero. Okay? Similarly with u. So this manifest as we already knew. So staying on a line of constant u is another thing. Staying on a line of the diagnostic for that is that there's no dv squared. Staying on a line of constant v is another thing. The diagnostic for that is that there's no du squared. Excellent. Now, what is the range of variation of u and v? Okay? Now, r is greater than 0. R is u plus v. V minus u. So v minus u is greater than 0. Other than that, v and u are completely unconstrained. Okay? Now, so I'm going to draw a diagram. Okay. So, we'll put in this condition in a moment. But imagine that it wasn't there. Then u and v would go both range from minus infinity to infinity. And we have this space-time in which u and v go from minus to infinity. Now, I want a visual representation of the space-time. Penrose invented a visual representation of the space-time, okay, which faithfully captures all the causal relationships of the original space-time. Okay, that's what I'm going to describe. Okay, so the way you do this is the bottom. See? V, if you want to draw a diagram of the space-time, because v and u go from minus infinity to infinity, it's a diagram that would fill all of your board and beyond. However, if I make a variable change, suppose I say v is equal to tan v, and u is equal to tan u. The fact that I'm using tan is not important. It's just some one-to-one function that ranges over a compact value when u and v go from point to point. So, if I ignored this, what would the range of u and v be? We would have a u belongs to minus pi by 2, pi by 2. V belongs to minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. This is where I ignore this. Now, taking this into account, since v and u are monotonic functions of the same monotonic function of u and v, the condition is simply that we've got this range plus that v is greater than u. Now I'm going to draw a diagram of the space. Okay? I'm going to draw a diagram of the space in which the u-axis and the v-axis will be depicted as tilted at 45 degrees to reflect the fact that they are lambda. Okay? So the diagram, first I'm going to draw this box, this diamond. What are lines of constant u? Lines of constant u are outgoing diagonals. Okay? Okay, these are lines of constant u. This is my definition. Okay? This okay, and simply these will be lines of constant. Okay, now in this diagram, time you should imagine is going upwards. Each of u and v increases, time increases, as you see from here. Okay? And space, roughly speaking, goes like this. So, as you go up on this diagram, u increases. So, this line here is u equals pi by 2. This line here is capital U. Sorry. Capital U equals pi by 2. This line here is u is equal to minus pi by 2. Whereas this line here is v equals pi by 2. This line here is v is equal to minus pi by 2. Okay? Now, in this space, I have not yet implemented the condition that v is greater than u. V is greater than u. Okay? This condition, however, just restricts us to the right hand side of u. Okay? Because this line is the line. It's the line r equals 0. Okay? And to the right of this, v is greater than u. So the diagram that the space-time that we are interested in this VU plane, goes like this. Okay, this is U equals minus pi by 2. This is V is equal to pi by 2. This is the line V equals U. Okay, these are lines of constant U, these are lines of constant V. And my whole space-time is depicted here. Now let me write out the metric of my space-time in these. Okay, the metric of my space-time is what? Is ds squared is equal to sec squared u sec squared v into du dv. Minus r squared cos squared u cos squared v. And r itself is a function of u and v. Right? In order to work out what function, though we won't really need it. To work out what function, we know that
v minus u, that r is 1v minus u by 2, right? So tan v minus tan by 2.
Exactly. So v minus u is equal to, by 2 is equal to r. And therefore, R is equal to 10 V minus 10 U. Okay? So, this metric with R substituted with this formula is the original metric of fixed time. Now, this looks like an enormously complicated metric. But notice that if we just dropped this factor, this overall factor, then as far as following radial light rays is concerned, this metric, dUdV, is the same as the original. So, up to an overall factor, it's true that this thing looks pretty complicated. But if we're not interested in that part, we're just looking at radial motion. Okay? Up to an overall factor, this metric is very simple. Okay? The metric is just up to an overall factor, just that. So in particular, light rays continue to move at 45 degrees in the capital U, capital V plane, just like they did in the small u, small u. So lines of constant capital U and lines of constant capital V continue to be null geodesics.
Yes, I have important key omission.
Thank you. Okay. Now, and the range of capital U and capital V is compact. So this little diagram here gives you a complete complete depiction of your space-time that is fully sufficient to determine causal questions. Okay? Suppose you want to know, you've got some point in space, and you want to know, can it affect, if you set the signal, can it reach here? It's just a question of whether it's inside or outside this 45 degree line drawn from here. Okay? You see that at any given point in space, for instance, okay, you can receive signals from. Okay. Now you see that there is. From this point of view, okay, what is this line? This line is just R equals zero. This is the origin of your spatial coordinates. What is this point? This is infinite time. This point was minus infinite time. And this point, if you think about it, was infinite space. R goes to infinity, keeping t fixed. However, in this diagram, you see that the boundary of space-time has a lot more to it than you might have thought. Okay? So as far as causal relations are concerned, the points t goes to infinity, keeping R fixed, the infinite future. Okay. Or R goes to infinity to keep t fixed. Are just small, particular examples of ways of going to infinity. There are other ways of going to infinity. R going to infinity and t going to infinity in the same way. So keeping R minus t fixed. Okay, those ways of going to infinity reach a point on this Penrose diagram, which is called Scribner's. Scribner's describes the future of all outgoing light rays. Any outgoing light ray in the future will eventually hit Scribner's. Just because all outgoing null geodesics align like this. Okay? This bar is called Scribner's and represents the path of any ingoing null geodesics. All ingoing null geodesics have come from this, I don't even know what these guys are called, I0 plus I0 by I0. These points here represent the past of all time-like observers. Because every time-like, no time-like can go for, you go to the past, you can't go at 45 degrees. Okay? So every time-like observer that has come from here. This is the future of all time-like observers. And this is just infinite distance at fixed time. Okay, so this is a sort of depiction of flat space. That for flat space is not terribly frigid, but its own when you start looking at black holes as we can start doing. So what we're going to try to do is to draw an equivalent diagram for a black hole space. And then we'll see what's interesting. But even here, suppose you're here and a bomb explodes, letting out light. What parts of space-time does it get an effect? Does this part? Where does light go? It goes to strike plus here. Okay? Fine. Now, so this thing was a Penrose diagram of flat space. And I didn't have too many surprises. But anyway. Now, what we're going to try to do is to understand this black hole that we wrote down by drawing a similar diagram. We're going to do this in steps. Okay. So, the first thing we need to do is to remember that we had these coordinates for the black hole that we u, which was t minus integral dr by 1 minus 2 m by r, and v, which was t minus integral dr plus 1 minus 2 m by r. This integral, by the way, is often called r sum. Okay. You'll often get in that people who see this about stuff, whatever that, the result of that integral. Which is, of course, an easy integral. Maybe we should also compute it. So let's compute our star. Our star is equal to integral dr over 1 minus 2m by r, which is equal to r dr by r minus 2m.
R plus log of
what?
R plus log of r.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So this is equal to r minus 2m plus 2m over r minus 2m over r minus 2m. So this is equal to r, as you said, plus 2m log of r minus 2m. Okay? We see many. We see many useful things in this expression. Firstly, at large r, the leading behavior of this is just r. So at large r, r star is not very different from r. However, when r goes to 2m, which is finite value, r star goes to minus infinity. Because we get log of c. Okay? So r star varies from minus infinity to infinity, as r varies from 2m to infinity. Remember, when okay. Now, last class, we described these null coordinates. We described the black hole in either null ingoing or null outgoing coordinates. Okay? Today we're going to look at the black hole in another set of coordinates. That, you know, in ingoing coordinates we used V and R. In ingoing alien Finkelstein coordinates, we used V and R as the coordinates we described. Outgoing coordinates we used U and R. You might ask, wonder why we're using U and V. This would be the analog of what we did to draw the Penrose diagram in flat space. Because these are the null coordinates. Okay? So let's draw it. Let's see what we get when we do du du. Okay? So now by definition, d of r star is 1 over 1 minus 2m by r. So this is equal to d minus dr by r. Okay? And so it's equal to the black hole space time that we started out with, apart from an overall factor. This is equal. So it follows that 1 minus 2m by r into du dv And now, for the rest of this discussion, I'm going to ignore the sphere part of the mention, the DS2 part of the mention, which plays no role in the discussion. Okay? Is equal to the original black one mentioned. D squared, you know, 1 minus 2 n by r, minus d r squared over 1. The original black one mentioned. Okay? This is sort of similar to the analysis in flat space. It's sort of similar to the analysis in flat space, except for one difference. There's an r here, which of course should be regarded as a function of u and v. Now, in these coordinates, the black hole metric is not manifestly non-zero. It was in the ur coordinates, so it was in the vr coordinates. But it isn't in these coordinates because something funny happens in the metric of these coordinates. Namely, the full metric vanishes. The determinant of the metric vanishes at r equals 2n. That's singularity in these coordinates because, for instance, the inverse metric will not exist. So these aren't yet satisfactory coordinates. They're not yet satisfactory coordinates. We can easily make them into satisfactory coordinates. Okay? The idea is that if we're going to do a coordinate change here, then we get rid of the zero. Okay? Now, let us remember what r was as a function of u and v. So, it's exactly like what we had before. R star is equal to v minus u by v. Right? Because v is equal to t plus r star. U is equal to t minus r star. So, v minus u by 2 is r star. And r star we know is a function of r. We just computed it. Okay? So, if you want this, you've got to take this relationship, invert it to find, you know, some using this r star. Okay? Using this, you invert it to find some relationship that will give you r is equal to r of v minus u. Right? Again, it's a complicated inversion because it's a complicated function. But in principle, you could invert this equation and find that expression. So here, when we write this r, we should think of it as a function of u, v, and u, obtained by plugging v minus u by 2 into this and solving for r as function. Okay? The important point, however, well, the first important point is that r star is not a function of v and u independently, but is a function of v minus u. Okay. Now, what I'm going to do now is what I'm now going to do is to try to get rid of the singularity here. And I'm going to do it as follows. Look. Then what do I get? Then what I get is 2n into log of r minus 2m is equal to v minus u by 2, so that's 5.4m. Okay? Now this relationship of course is very easy to put, because we get r minus 2m is equal to e to the power of v minus u by 4.
There was a plus, r plus 2m.
Say that again? But I'm saying, suppose we go to the, you're talking about this? Suppose we go to the neighborhood of r near to it. This term dominates this. So the neighborhood of the vectorized, where things are going bad. And we can forget about this. So everything interesting is happening from here. So in the neighborhood of that vectorized, we get this equation, right? Now, this suggests the following. Change of variance. Suppose we have v is equal to e to the power. Exactly. Right. So you see, this is the kind of factor that we have out here. Okay? So this is the kind of factor that we have out here. So this is the kind of thing that we want to obtain as the from the change of variance. So suppose I do for it. Suppose I do v is equal to e to the power of v by 4. And u is equal to e to the power minus u by 4. So suppose I make this change of variance. Okay? Then you see that the metric, which was okay, so then first let's write down what DUDV is. DUDV is equal to e to the power v minus u by 4m du dv. Okay? So that du dv is this object and has the same kind of singularity as the physical metric. Precisely, since this physical metric has a 1 by r here, du dv by 2n. Okay, in the neighborhood of the event horizon becomes whatever this is at 2m. So it's approximately r minus 2m by 2n. Which is approximately r minus 2m by r. 1 minus 2m by r. Du. Which is the true metric. Do you see? Okay? So do you say that the metric, the black hole metric, in the neighborhood of the horizon, is desingularized by moving to these capital V, capital U coordinates? Because in this metric, expanding to leading order,
it's 1 minus r by 2.
Right, but we are expanding near r equals 2. So the only thing. So this is, as far as that's concerned, you see, what I'm saying is that these two differ, but this is 1 over r into r minus 2m. And this is 1 over 2n power minus 2n. Yeah, r equals 2n, these are the same. It's only the difference between r and 2n that we keep. Every other place we said R equals 2. Okay? So, now, what I'm saying is that this funny looking metric in the little u, little v coordinates becomes just a very simple metric in the capital V, capital U coordinates. Okay? So, now let's be a little more precise. We'll just work with these with these capital U and capital V coordinates and write down the full blackboard metric without making approximation. Okay? What we guaranteed is that this metric will not have any singularities at the event horizon. Because we've just got the expansion term at the event horizon. And we've seen that in the neighborhood of the event horizon, this the metric is just the UDV of your constant. Okay? So this is the motivation for making this change to the universe. Doing the expansion near the event horizon, and then saying that this is the change of variables we need to desingularize it. Is this completely clear? Okay? Once we know what change of variables we want to make, of course it's just algebra. This was a metric. We want to rewrite it in terms of these U and V coordinates, capital U and capital V coordinates, so let's do that. So what is the metric? It is 1 minus 2m by r into, now, du is equal to d capital U into e to the power plus u by 4m.
Actually, it will become minus again because of the u.
minus.
So there is a minus 1 and square, so there is a minus and minus.
Well,
2 minus is cancelled.
This minus was there from the differentiation.
Yeah.
Okay, so here there was a minus.
Okay. Another minus will be
1 minus from du and 1 minus from u.
Exactly.
So 2 is cancelled, but this minus is minus.
Right. So actually, there was no minus. And then the u. Okay. Now writing out what they claim that the answer is. Let's write it down and then we'll check it.
So they say that we get
that you can write ds squared is equal to minus 32 m cubed by r e to the power minus r by n b u v v and we don't say much where u v is equal to minus r minus m by 2 m e to the power r r by 2 m. Let's check this. Okay. First, let's check this. Let's check that u v as we have defined it obeys this property. That's obvious, actually. You see, uv was minus of e to the power v minus u by 4n. Okay. Now v minus u was 2r star. Okay? It was equal to minus e to the power r star by 2n. But r star was r plus that log. Okay, it was equal to minus e to the power r by 2m times e to the power, and there was a log of r minus 2m. So we get, and there was 2m log r minus 2m. Remember, r star had 2m times log r minus 2m, so the 2m's cancel. So we get
only r by 2m.
Where do we get this extra 2m? Did I start? Or maybe that was an integration cost. In R star, I'm going to modify, okay? My R star was equal to R plus log of R minus 2m plus constant. Okay? And I'm going to choose the constant to be log minus log 2m. So this becomes the dimensions. Yeah, that's how I'm going to do. Then you get the 2m. And we're happy, right? So we've confirmed that uv is equal to this. Okay, so that's the relationship between r and u times v. Okay? And now we want to confirm that in these new coordinates, the metric takes that form. Okay, so let's see. So what was the metric? The metric was minus 4m the whole thing squared, 1 minus 2m by r, into this, and then we substitute v minus u is 2r star, so this is minus, this is e to the power minus 2r star by, sorry, minus r star by 2m, du dv. And then we make the same substitution. Okay, so let's make the substitution. So we get, this is just exactly inverse of this. So we get minus 4m the whole thing squared, you know, 1 minus 2m by r, divided by e to the power r by 2m into r minus 2m by 2m. Okay. So that becomes what?
Is 1 minus 2 by r.
Yeah, 1 minus 2. Yeah, but there's what remains is 2m divided by r.
So you make this 2m by r. 1 with the bracket downward is by r. Then 1 minus 2m by r cancels.
Right. So you get 2m divided by r.
times 4n squared. Squared times e to the power minus r by 2n. That's a minus. So that's 4 into 4 into 2, that's 32. M into n squared, that's m cubed. Divided by r, e to the power, so r by 2, I just presumed it. Yeah, that's 2.
Minus, so that capital U increases when little u increases.
the part of the thing that was all of space-time in the little u and all of the patch that little u and little v saw is 0 to infinity in v and minus infinity to 0 in u. Or the other way. No, 0 to infinity in v and minus infinity to 0 in u. But we have seen that nothing funny happens to the metric in the u-v coordinates as u and v go to 0. So, we can just take this metric and regard it as a true metric of our space-time. Or, you know, regard it as a perfectly fine metric for arbitrary values of a capital U and big U. A capital U and capital V. So, this is a metric that manifestly agrees with outside the event horizon of the black hole in the region, in these two regions, but makes sense everywhere. Because nothing funny happens when capital U and capital V go to 0. All that happens is that R goes to 2n. But who cares? Metric's perfectly smooth. Is this clear? Okay. So, the full space-time, we will tentatively say, is U belonging to minus infinity to infinity. And V belonging to minus infinity. Okay. But, hang on for a minute. Is that really the full space? You see, while R equals 2m is not a real singularity in the Schwarzschild space-time, there is a genuine singularity in the Schwarzschild space-time. That's at R equals 0. Okay? So if you go to R equals 0, then it's easy to check. I haven't checked for you, but it's easy to check. Curvature is actually known. It's a genuine singularity of the Schwarzschild space-time. Okay? And we don't, you know, you're not going to be able to continue your space-time past that curvature singularity. It's not smooth manifold. So where does R equals 0 sit in the space? In order to find that, let's appeal to this formula. R equals 0 is the equation UV is equal to minus 1. Plus. UV is equal to minus 2. UV is equal to R equals 1. Sorry, A is equal to 1. Okay. So, let's do the kind of thing. Okay, excellent. So now, all of space-time...
So this we are saying, when we are using the relation that we have already found the limits for unity. Then, and we are using the relation like how we define capital U and capital U. And that, from there we already know the limits on U and V. We know that we are...
No, this space-time is supposed to be this metric with this relationship. You're supposed to solve for R as a function of UV. From here, plus.
But for this situation, you already have a limit on what the value of capital
U. No. This is not the full space time. You see, we got this space time by looking at what it was in the UV patch. But now our idea is to take this space time and trust it everywhere we can. It's like an analytic continuation of a function. You know the function in a disk. And then you ask, can I use the same formulas to define it over the whole complex thing? It's like that. Okay? As long as there's nothing stopping me, I'll do it. Okay? Fine. So, this, we're going to be stopped when UV is equal to plus 1. Okay? I'm now going to try to draw a picture of this space-time along the lines of our Penrose diagram. Okay, so let's do that. I'll keep this on the board. Okay, so
if it's small u and small v, like you and v going from minus infinity to infinity, you are not able to define the space.
Yeah, actually, more technically, what happens is that this space time is geodesically incomplete. Which means, as we've seen, as we saw last class, that if you're an observer, you can reach the boundary of that space-time in finite property. So that space-time does not answer the question, what happens to the observer at 5 o'clock in the evening? At 5 o'clock in the evening, at his watch, he reaches the boundary of the space-time, then what? It makes no sense. Okay?
We were able to write the metric in terms of small a, small u.
What?
Small a, small u, yes. Write the metric. And yes. there is a relation between u, small a, small u, and r.
Yes. That relationship works outside the directions.
So how is this different? Like, what is this different between small u, small u, and capital u? In these two relations, I can say that I'm covering the whole space. Right?
That
is like...
That in these two... say about space time. You see, what we're going to find is that this metric that we get by extending it to the maximum form in capital U and capital D is not geometrically incomplete. That is, for every observer, for infinite proper time along his world line, where you lie within this full metric. Okay? See, suppose you take the Schwarzschild metric as a metric that is defined only outside the endurance. That makes no sense. Because, as we just discussed, you know, an observer drifting along in his rocket ship will reach the edge of this space-time at finite proper time. Curvatures are fine and smooth and nothing catastrophic is happening to him. You must be able to answer the question, what happens to him? Okay? So it makes no sense to do that. So what are the options? The options are that, but it was a solution to Einstein's equations. This solution in this coordinate system developed a singularity. What are the options? The options are, look, we found a solution to Einstein's equations, but somehow because we were using stupid coordinates, we found it in only one coordinate patch. Now what we're trying to do is to find the solution. Whose one coordinate patch is the Schwarzschild solution? Okay? Now, because we're looking at solutions of Einstein gravity without any sources, the solution is going to be completely analytic. It's not going to be like there's a non-analyticity in the solution somewhere. And the only way that could happen is if there's a non-analytic source. Solutions without sources. Okay? So what we're looking for is nice, smooth space-time. That, an analytic function of coordinates, that in some region reduces to what we already had by a coordinate choice. Okay? So I'm now going to solve, what I'm going to do for you solves that inverse problem. You take this space time. Imagine God has given it to you. You know, somebody's given it to you. This is, you've got the space time. Now, in this space time, I'll find a patch which, under an appropriate coordinate change, becomes exactly the Schwarzschild. But this space-time has no pathologies. None of the pathologies associated with this question. So it's the true solution. We should have used these coordinates. Then we will found the solution. You can later then check this in these coordinates. That's all Einstein's equation there.
It's not a place we can see by there is no singularity.
There's no singularity except the coordinate, r equals 0 singularity.
That's why this should be a...
Yeah, and we're going to see this. The diagram I draw will make it a bit clearer. Okay. Now, look, we've got this U and V business going on, this capital U, capital V. So, now we're going to play the same game that we played in space-time to draw vectors. This is a nice, perfectly smooth space-time. The only thing that's not so nice depicting it in our minds in a diagram is that U and V go to over infinite space. So we play the same tricks that we did before. Namely, we let U is equal to tan. We're running out of letters. I would have liked to use nil u, but that's too confusing. See, think of some letter that reminds you of u.
Ukraine.
Is that good enough? Okay. I'll tell that. Okay. Prime thing that reminds you of tan. Okay. And v is equal to tan v. Okay. Now, of course, plugging this then gives you the metric in terms of this tan v tilde, the v tilde u tilde coordinates. The details of the metric are not very interesting. The most important thing is what are the ranges of the world. Like the sort of classes. So, okay, firstly, U is capital U and capital V range from minus infinity to infinity, just like in flat space. V tilde and U tilde will range from minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. However, this space time is going to be cut off along the lines capital U, capital V is equal to 1. Okay, so first let's draw this. So first we have this diamond that we drew also from flat space. Okay, this is U is equal to minus pi by 2, this line is U is equal, no, U tilde. So U tilde is equal to pi by 2, this line is V tilde is equal to pi by 2, V tilde is equal to minus pi by 2. Okay, and though it doesn't look like it, this diagram is a square. These are 90 degrees. Now, the next question is, what are the lines UV is equal to 1? Capital U, capital V is equal to 1. Which is the same as the question, what are the lines tan U tilde, tan V tilde is equal to 1. But now think about it. Suppose V tilde was pi by 2 minus U tilde. Then tan V tilde would be cot U tilde, and this relationship would be satisfied. Okay? So one way this can be satisfied is if V tilde must be plus U tilde. Was equal to pi by 2. Is there any other way of satisfying it? Well, how about V tilde is minus pi by 2 plus tilde. Let's see, there's one other way of saying it.
3 pi by 2
is? 3 pi by 2, which is the same as minus pi by 2. Is that right? Let me check this. I want tan of V tilde is 1 over tan of V tilde. So one way is having sine and cos being interchanged. The other way is having sine and cos being interchanged with a minus sign. The thing that does that is there. Right. So it's pi minus pi minus. Just let me depict this first line here. We'll get the second one by symmetry. Okay, and then we'll check it. Okay, let me find this first line. This first line here is V tilde plus U tilde is equal to pi by 2. So, if we were to draw this square like this, this would have been a 45 degree line like this, and it would have been a 45 degree line that passed through pi by 2. So, okay,
from the median of that point to the middle of that point.
Yeah, it's from the middle of this to the middle. Okay, and I'm claiming that this also does it, which means, I suppose,
then I just want to replace pi by 2 by minus pi by 2. And let me check for that. Okay. So suppose v tilde is equal to minus pi by 2 plus v tilde, then sine is minus cos. But cos,
is sine, then minus
tilde,
then
perfect.
Tilde,
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 tilde.
Good.
So that agrees with this. So it must work. I'm not exactly seeing it. I'll accept that. And he's right. He's right. It's clear that it works, right? If pi worked. But did I just minus?
Minus.
Thank you, thank you. It worked minus before, and it's minus now. Now it works. Thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you. And that's exactly what we want, right? Same slope. But different intercept. Here it's pi by 2, here it's minus pi by 2. Okay? So it's right in the middle of this square. So I'll draw this a little better so that it looks like this. So this is what it was. And then we take this part and cut it off. This part is not there. This part is also not there. Okay. And now to make this diagram look fancy, we draw this line with a Mookie. Okay? Because weakly lines are supposed to represent singularities. Okay? This diagram is not geodesically complete because... Okay, let's draw this. Other important things. Okay? Now I'm going to give you daily settings. This thing here is called a singularity. Okay? This is also a singularity. Here we have stripers. Just like for flat space. It's where if you stand. Okay. This is stripers. And then there's another stripers and another stripers. Okay, these points are the spatial infinity. These points are the time. Okay, now let's go back to this diagram and look at it. In this diagram, where was the original patch that was outside our black hole? It was this. This was the patch that represented the little u and little v coordinates. Little u and little v going from minus infinity to infinity. Okay? This. You can check that it's the right part.
This is outside the event
horizon. Outside the event horizon.
It has one. The singularity point is also 0.
Minus.
Has one point.
Yeah, this is a bit misleading because you know you multiply by infinite factors here. So it's a bit, this point is a whole space time. It's a bit misleading to think of that. Yeah, but in this compactification. Okay. Now you remember the first thing we did in the last lecture is go to these ingoing Eddington Finkelstein coordinates. Ingoing Eddington Finkelstein coordinates were constant along lines of V
And we found that the event horizon was nice and smooth in these coordinates. Now, what are these ingoing lines? These are these lines. We also looked at the coordinates in outgoing area between this time. Those were lines of constant U and R bent. What were those lines? Those were these lines. And we also concluded that the event horizon was smooth in these coordinates. Now look at this diagram and see that we've actually concluded the smoothness of different things. This was the event horizon that we saw in the ingoing and interface. This was the event horizon that we saw in the outgoing end. The point where these two diagrams meet on the Penrose diagram is named called the bifurcation. Okay, it's an important point when studying the properties of eternal black holes. We will have very nice. Okay, now there are several things I want to say. Look at this diagram. In this diagram, look at this upper triangle. Suppose you're here. Your future light cone goes here. So any signal you send from here will go and hit the signal. Anything, no matter what you do, you will also go and hit the signal. On the other hand, suppose you're here. A signal you send has two options. One is to go in and hit the signal. The other is to go out and go to scribe plus, as if the black hole wasn't there, just like in flat space. You yourself also have two options. You can either go and fall into the black hole or go out. It's up to you. Okay? What about if you're here? If you're here, all of your past. If you're here, all of your past lies in this area. Okay? Everything that has happened has had in this space-time, this twin space-time, we talk about its relation to actual black holes. This is what's called an eternal black hole. It's a mathematical idealization of a black hole. It's formed in ideas, as we will discuss. Okay? But in this maximally analytically continued space-time, in this space-time, okay, we have a region here and two distinct singularities. One of which is the past of everything, except light rays that are emerging. Right? And actually there's also these points are also past. Okay? Oh my, there's this talk, it's here. Okay, we're gonna have it. Okay? Whereas, so this region is called the white. Because everything in its past was the singular. Whereas this region is called the black. Because everything in its future is the singular. Okay? And this another really strange thing about this diagram is that in this diagram there are two asymptotic scribe pluses and two asymptotic scribe minuses. So this diagram depicts two universes. Two universes in which people can grow up, be happy, and die, never communicating with each other. Except through going into the same black hole. They go into the same black hole, they can talk for a while, not for too long. Okay? So it's very strange. This space-time is, when you look at it from here, it looks like a small deviation of that space, but a global structure, it's very different. It describes two universes connected by what's called an Einstein-Rosen bridge wall. Okay. Now this is the structure of the space-time. One last thing I want to say about it. Last thing I want to say about it was that in this diagram, what do lines of constant t, the original Schwarzschild diameter, right, in this region? Okay, lines of constant time look the following. Okay, they look like this. Okay, and this event horizon line, this line that separates being inside the black hole from being outside the black hole, is a line of t equals infinity or t equals minus infinity. Okay, and that, if you look at it, and maybe we can supplement it. Okay, if you look at it, is connected to the fact that this is described by the v coordinate. Because in the v coordinate, v is equal to t, was it minus r, t plus r star. Okay? Now, if v is held fixed, and r star goes to minus infinity, then t must be going to plus infinity. But r star does go to minus infinity. Okay? So, this region here, the region explored by the ingoing Eddington Finkelstein coordinates, are the line t equals infinity. This whole line here is at t equals infinity. The region explored by outgoing Eddington Finkelstein coordinates, t equals minus infinity. Okay, we don't have to stop in 2 minutes because we stop. But actually, there are many interesting things about, you know, I really advise you to stay in this diagram. 2 minutes more. Stare at this diagram and think about it. Very interesting. Okay, well, in the last 2 minutes, I have to make the following important physical problem. This sounds totally weird, you know. This sounds totally weird because black holes in our universe can be formed by collapse. That's what we'll talk about in our last lecture of this course. Monday will be the last lecture of the course. Because I have to go over time next week. It's basically time off. Okay, but 2 minutes, 2 minutes. what we described in the last lecture of this course is more about black holes, but about formation of black holes and other properties. But black holes in our universe can be formed by collapse. Now, you don't expect a little localized collapse process to give birth to a whole new universe. You know, flat spaces didn't have these regions. Can a black hole be really have these regions? No. The important thing is that the space-time for this is what is called an eternal black hole. Space-time for a black hole that will always be there in the future and has always been there in the past. Okay? Suppose you look at a metric for a black hole that is formed from collapse. There's a very simple metric that, you know, the famous Indian physicist Vaidya wrote. First wrote down. To describe a black hole formed from the collapse of a short burst of null light. Okay, you take a shell of light that's very thin, that implodes inwards, starts spherical, and implodes inwards. The shell of light contains energy, and once it becomes small enough, can create a black hole. The details of when that happens is interesting, but essentially the point is this. Look. A shell of light carries some energy. Suppose this light has some thickness to it. Okay? When the thickness of the light is much smaller than the Schwarzschild radius associated with that energy, the light just sails into its Schwarzschild radius without interacting with itself. But now the metric outside the light becomes Schwarzschild. And once it's inside its event horizon, this thing is inside its event horizon, no matter what happens here, the black hole is formed. This very beautiful metric that Bentley wrote down in a particular limit for certain processes. And that is dS squared is equal to 1 minus 2m of V by R. Okay? dV squared minus 2 dV dR plus the usual R squared dV. Where m of V is a function that interpolates from 0 at V equals minus infinity to a constant at some time. Actually, this metric is only accurate for this process. this metric sourced by null, what they call null dust, light rate. It's only accurate when MOV varies rather quickly. The thickness of the pulse is not very much. Okay? Now for such a metric, you see if M was constant, it would be the black hole metric we talked about before. But M is not constant, starts from zero and then goes to something. Now you can ask, what is the Penrose diagram of such a black hole? Not going to describe it for you in detail, but I'll just tell you the answer. The answer is this. So it has this part of the black hole diagram, but not the white hole part and not the other universe. Okay? Here's inside the black hole, here's outside the black hole. So black holes that are formed by collapse, for instance, of this shell of dust. Okay, I'll add one problem to your problem set, just one more. Okay, though I promised it would be the last, to describe this process in some way. Okay? These things have a Kruskal, have a Penrose diagram that looks like this. It's a part of this diagram. Okay? Removing this part. It's a part of this diagram. It has some of the elements of this diagram, but not the weird elements. So this diagram here describes a mathematically convenient space-time in which you do interesting calculations that capture the physics of realistic situations where black holes are formed by collapse. Okay, I think that's all I want to say for today. Let's continue on Monday. Once again, these lectures